Welcome to church, everybody. Why don't you stand to your feet? And if you put your hands together like this for me, come on. We have so many things to be grateful for today. Sing this with me, your word.
Your word is the lamp unto my feet. Hey. Your way is the only way for me. It's a narrow road that leads to life, and I wanna be on it. It's a narrow road, and the mercy's wide. You're good on your promise.
Come on, sing this with me.
I'll take you at your word. Hey. If you start it, I'll believe it. I've seen how good it works. If you start it, you'll complete it. I'll take you at your word.
Hey. You spoke.
The chaos fell in, and I know, 'cause I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road that leads to life, and I wanna be on. Eternity in your hands.
my soul now this day. You stood before my failures and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now stands.
I know you know this part, sing it with me.
So what can I say? And what can I do? But offer this all. Upon silence.
thousand generations falling down in worship to sing a song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe sing a song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing a song forever to the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear His name, sing a song forever to the Lamb.
Your name is the highest, and your name is the greatest, your name. is our God. Come on, church, sing it with me. You're the name above all names. Oh, you're the name above. Hallelujah. Yes, you are God. Worthy of praise. My heart will sing. Yes, is our God.
Beginning at 6:30 p.m., bring your first through fourth grader to a night of games, friends, and worship at Kaboom!
And while your kids are having a blast at Kaboom, you have the opportunity to dive deeper into Scripture at the Mine.
Since they're going deeper into Romans, I felt compelled to be here.
Tuesdays are better at Cornerstone.
We'll see you Tuesday nights at Cornerstone.
Hey, what's going on, Cornerstone? Hey, for those I haven't been able to meet, my name's Brian. I get to serve as the executive pastor for our church. And so we'll start out by saying, welcome back, Cornerstone family. It's great to see you guys again. Welcome to those of you joining us online. And I want to make sure we stop and give a special welcome to those of you that are new, especially if this is your first time being in the room with us. Welcome to you. We'd love to connect with you. Probably the easiest way to do that is if you text NEW to 21999. You're going to find out we text all kinds of things to 21999. Take out your phone, text NEW. We'll connect with you that way. Or when you go out to the lobby, just to the left, there's a NEW here, Start Here booth, and somebody there would love to speak with you, and they've got a free gift for you just for being our guest. So welcome. And if you are new, maybe this is your first time, maybe you've been here for a few months now and still trying to figure Cornerstone out, like what are my steps to take here at Cornerstone? We've got something for you. It's called Next Steps. Next Steps happens the second service every week just outside in one of the classrooms of our lobby. There's 4 weeks to it, and every week's different, so you can jump in at any time. 1 week, we help you find your community, those smaller spaces to develop friendships that you have for life. 1 week, we help you find your team. All of you are gifted in ways to give back to the body of Christ here at Cornerstone. We want to help you find a place to do that. 1 week, we talk about who we are, and then another, how you belong. But all four are there for you. Text Next Steps to 21999. Get more info about that. But second service every week just outside. I want to encourage you to be with us there. Hey, we've talked about this over the past several weeks, but this week we launch out into all of our marriage ministries. There's something there for almost everyone. We've got merge, which is for premarital. Like, you're not married yet. You're heading there. And maybe you want to find out all those surprises that you'll find out later. You want to know about those now. We're going to help you do that. We've got re-engage. Maybe you've been married for 10, 20 years, and there's something that's become the center of your marriage. Maybe it's kids in the season. Maybe it's work. And there's a little distance between you and the one sitting next to you. Re-engage is a place for you to get connected again, to put Jesus back in the center of your marriage. We've got that for you. Maybe you've been through a broken relationship. There's a place for healing and grace for you too. Text marriage to 21999 to learn about all the places for you to get plugged in around marriage here at Cornerstone. Hey, I don't know about you, but I just saw a video a few minutes ago about a men's conference that has an alligator at it. I don't know what's that about, but I'm going to come and check it out. For our men in the room, that conference is outstanding, designed just for you. There's an alligator. We've got Mike Drogic coming. Chris Hilken, who we all know and love, is coming to speak as well. There's games. There's fun. There's food. There's all things for men. But most of all, there's community for men. There's a place to grab friends for life, mentorship, community there at our Legacy Men's Conference. Text LEGACY to 21999. To learn all the details about that, get registered, and you don't want to miss it. Just be here with us for that night. I want to come back to our Cornerstone family, too, for just a minute. I want to say thanks so much for just the type of church that you are. Your generosity, your tithes, your offerings move forward the mission and ministry here at our church. We do a lot here. We do a lot to reach people for Jesus, to invest in the families here, but everything we do is because God saves and because you give. So just want to say thanks for that. And if you haven't taken that step yet, it's easy to do. You can do it today. Just text GIVE to 21999 and be a part of everything God wants to do here in our family of faith. There's something special about this weekend. In the back seat in front of you, there's an elder info card. So once a year, we'll come before you and say, here are elder placements for the upcoming year. That card, again, is in the seat back in front of you. And here's the ask. You'll grab that. Gives you an opportunity for a bio about our elders, for you to affirm or comment, and then you can drop it off in the baskets on your way out right there by the door. But the ask is for you to engage in that today. Something else that's special about this weekend. We do have a guest speaker with us this weekend. You would know him. You love him. He's been a lifelong friend for Cornerstone, but Brad Wilkerson is back in the house this weekend. So in just a moment, when he makes his way to the stage, give him a warm Cornerstone welcome as he continues us in this series, Experiencing God.
After getting born again, it was like I walked around with my hands up saying, God, pick me, I'll do it. I fell so much in love with him. So when I was diagnosed with MS, I couldn't understand why. Lost the fine motor skills in both my hands. My right leg would not lift off the ground, but worse, I went blind. I got pretty sad. Didn't understand why God allowed me to go through that. I've been serving at Cornerstone for 22 years. I was a greeter at the front door. So I stayed in the wheelchair and didn't do much except greet. But I didn't stop serving, and I didn't stop praying with people. And I was blessed to pray for a lady that asked me to pray for her who had cancer. 2 weeks later, she came back to me and told me that she was totally healed from the cancer. You know, I went home and I screamed to the creator of the universe saying, what's wrong with me? Why aren't I healed? I really thought in my heart that I was doing something wrong, and I felt like I was being punished by God. If I do good, he'll do good for me. I kept saying, what did I do wrong? And he said to me, he said, what if you're doing everything right, but yet God's using it to bless others, so the Holy Spirit guides us to help other people, and it gets our eyes off ourselves. It's not like he's a candy box or a candy machine. You know, we just press the button and it happens. God gave me the scripture, I shall not die, but live to proclaim what the Lord has done. And here I am. I'm still serving after 22 years of greeting at the front door and loving every second of it. You see, when you get your eyes off of yourself and onto other people's needs, we become less and he becomes more.
Well, how are we doing, Cornerstone? You guys having a great morning? You ready for church? It's good to see all of you. Man, I told Donna I'd just come to hear her sing every week. Wow, worship was great in here today. Thanks for letting me be back with you. I was here third weekend in December, and if you weren't here, let me make sure you know that I reside and I pastor in what we call the great nation of Texas. I got some Texans out there? Yeah, well, yeah, okay. It's good to be back in Arizona, man. Great time of the year to be here. It's exciting to be back with you. And before I dive in this week to our message, can we just celebrate that today is Pastor Lynn and Lisa's 42nd wedding anniversary today? Let's just celebrate that. You guys have been in a series for the last few weeks called Experiencing God, and we're going to continue in that series today as we're going to take it a step further, and we're going to look at another idea or another thought of how God wants us to know Him and experience His will for our lives. You kicked this series off, Pastor Lynn, week one, talked about the fact that God is always at work. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. He's working all the time. He's constantly at work. I say it this way at our church. We play checkers. God plays chess. He's five steps ahead of us. And He's always working, and He's working things for His glory and our good. Week two talked about the fact that God wants a loving relationship with each of us. Listen, God wants a relational connection, not a religious ritual. He wants to be connected to us relationally. And then last week, Pastor Scott talked about God's grand invitation to join Him in His work, to be about the big K kingdom, His kingdom, not our little K kingdoms in this world. And we do that by engaging in what He's doing in the local church and getting on mission with Him. Now, this week, we're going to go to a topic that might wig some people out. If you were like me and you were raised old school, independent, fundamental, King James only Baptist, don't let this wig you out, okay? But step four in this Experiencing God journey is this step right here. God speaks. God speaks. God speaks, God has spoken, and God continues to speak. And while this is going to be very practical today, here's what I know about you and I in our faith journey. We get so familiar with God that we become unfamiliar with God. And so I want you to press in and learn again. And for the first time, for some of you, maybe this is the first time you're going to hear some of this. Press in, listen to God speak in this room, in this moment, right now. God speaks. I think God is always speaking. I just think sometimes we just aren't really listening. God is speaking. We just aren't always listening. For instance, if I were to tell you today that I have spoken with God before I came to preach, everybody would say, oh, that's spiritual. But if I had told you I heard from the voice of God before I came on the stage today, a lot of you'd say, that's crazy. We classify people as cray-cray because they claim they've heard the voice of God or they've heard God speak. But listen, God is speaking. He's always speaking. He wants us to get on the same wavelength with Him and tune in, watch, to the voice of Him, not the voice of the lie of culture. I know this about you, and I know this about me, because we're just people. And there are no perfect people, and we all need grace. Amen? By the way, I preach a lot shorter if you amen. Told you. I'm from the belt buckle of the Bible Belt, man. My people shout at me, go preacher, go boy. So I had a guy say the other day, man, you preach with a little flavor. I don't know what that means. But for some reason, we classify people who talk to God as spiritual, but we classify people who hear from God as crazy. But God is speaking, and He's always speaking. We just aren't always listening. And so here's what happens. We get distracted, and you and me, we have this experience in life where we think the devil is who makes us bad. But the truth is, the devil isn't trying to make you bad. He's not trying to make me bad, because we've mastered the art of that on our own. The devil's trying to make you busy. He's trying to distract you with the busyness of the world and the busyness of technology and the busyness of your schedule. So that, watch this, you are not tuned in to hear the voice of God, because God's always speaking. We're just not always listening. And so I want to give you three practical things today, three practical ways that God is speaking in our time, in our generation, in our culture today. The first one is this, write it down. God is speaking through His Word and His Spirit. Now, when I say His Word, I'm referring to the Scriptures, the Holy Bible. And you can see on these two pages, I've marked them so you can see God speaks as you read His Word. Somebody said after the first service, you shouldn't write in your Bible. I said, I'm sorry, I do. God speaks through His Word. Here's what you need to know. God speaks through what He's already spoken. It's right here. The living, breathing, inspired, full authority and full truth in His Word. There was a lady in our church that came up to me in the lobby a few weeks ago, and she showed me her Bible, and her Bible was completely worn out. She's a widow lady in her church, loves Jesus with all her heart, been following Him for many years, and her Bible was literally falling apart from all the reading of it. We need a generation of Bibles that are falling apart. She walks up to me and she says, Pastor, my Bible's falling apart. I'm finally going to buy a new Bible. What translation do you suggest I buy? Well, in that moment, I felt like Jesus and the Pharisees because I thought she was trapping me with a question of a debate of translations. How many of you know that can get cray-cray in church these days? So I said, Holy Spirit, speak. Tell me what to tell her. So I looked at her and I said, buy the translation that you'll actually read. She's like, I never thought about that. I said, yeah, I think we're debating on which translation's the greatest or the best, and the whole time that we're debating, we're not meditating. The whole time we're debating and arguing about things, we're not in His Word because the devil uses the distractions of our culture. God speaks. God speaks through this, His Holy Scripture. And somebody in here today, you've walked in, you're like, if God would part the Red Sea for me, I'd believe in Him. If God would heal blind eyes and deaf ears and lame legs would walk, I would believe in Him. Listen, stop looking for a sign, look for a verse. It's all in here. Everything you need for a guide for life is contained in the Scriptures. Paul, the Apostle Paul, the greatest church planter the world has ever known. Paul is writing to his young apprentice Timothy about the Word of God. He's writing to Timothy, but he's also writing to us today. He says this in 2 Timothy chapter 3. All Scripture, not just the parts you like, all Scripture is inspired by God. And it is useful to teach us what is true. Aren't you glad there is a book that teaches us what is truth? And to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. Don't miss those two words, our lives. I've been in church all my life. I had a drug problem as a really young child. I was drugged to church every weekend by my parents. I was in church before I was born. My mother played the organ. I was in her belly when she was playing Just As I Am at the end of every service. And here's what I know about church people, because I am one. We love to take what Scripture says and point out the faults in everybody else's lives. And Paul says to Timothy, it is a personal diagnosis. This is for you. This is a prescription to diagnose your life individually, not just those around you. He says it corrects us when we are wrong. And it teaches us to do what is right. God uses it to prepare and equip His people to do every good work. Write this down. The more you are in His Word, the more His Word will be in you. And the more that you're in His Word, the less you'll be in the world. God speaks through His Scripture. God speaks through what He's already spoken. But there's another piece to this. He speaks through His Word, but He speaks through His Spirit, the Holy Spirit. How many of you know you can read a verse on Monday and say one thing to you and read that same verse on Friday and it say something completely different? What is that? How is that happening? Because it's the same words on the same page. It's the illumination of the Holy Spirit as God speaks to you as you dive into His Word. He speaks through His Spirit In fact, Jesus said it this way in John 16, speaking to his disciples. His disciples, he knows that he's about to go to the cross. He's going to die for the sins of mankind. He's going to be risen again 3 days later. And eventually, he's going to ascend back to the Father. And he needs these closest followers of him to know some things when he's not around. How many of you know when the boss leaves, people get a little bit funny? And so he wants them to know some things about how they're to live and how they're to minister in his absence. And he wants them to know he's not going to leave them alone. He says in John 16, when the Spirit of truth comes. Now, anytime you see the word Spirit in your Bible with a capital S, that's the Holy Spirit. He says, when the Holy Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but he will tell you what he has heard. He will tell you about the future. He will bring me glory by telling you whatever he receives from me. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will tell you whatever he receives from me. The Spirit will never tell you anything that contradicts what God has already spoken in his word. And the Holy Spirit will tell you things that the Father has revealed to him. Things that you need to know and things I need to know. Things about the future. How many of you would like to have known the future in March of 2020? Come on. Yeah, yeah. Wouldn't the church really have liked to have known what was coming? The Holy Spirit reveals things, the unknown to us. The detached things, the unknown things, the mysterious things. The Holy Spirit reveals it, but it never contradicts the Word. You guys remember back in the Stone Age, the 1980s? Greatest decade ever. Can I get a witness? Yeah, buddy. Back when our telephones weren't handheld computers, back when our telephones were canary yellow or avocado green and they were mounted to our walls. Come on, our landlines. You remember those days? Yeah. Don't you wish you'd go back to those days? Yeah. So I remember those days at home, and when I wanted to have a private conversation with my girlfriend, we had a really long cord. And I'd go into the other room, and I'd shut the door so I could have a private conversation. And then when I'd stretch that cord out, it'd get all tangled up when I'd bring it back to the phone. And so we'd have to get on top of the kitchen table and hold it like this so it would spin. Remember that? Come on. Come on. Yeah, the good old days. Yeah, 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 yeah. And then this deal called caller ID came along, this little box that you tie into your phone. And so you could see when your mama was calling, and you didn't want to talk to your mama because you knew you were in trouble, so you didn't answer. Or if the boss called, you're like, I don't want to talk to him. But just for a minute, go back to days pre-caller ID. Think about answering the phone before there ever was caller ID. By the way, before caller ID, we could just dial any random number to hang up, and it was fun. Can't do that anymore, right? But let's just assume that there's no caller ID. I can tell you, if my phone rang right now, and there was no caller ID that said on the screen, wife, I would know it was my wife, Sarah, by the sound of her voice. If my son, my 24-year-old son, called and it didn't say Ryder on the screen, I would know it was him by the sound of his voice and the few words that he chooses to say. How you doing today? Fine. What are y'all doing? Nothing. It's just a man, a few words. If I looked down and I saw that it said Haley, my 29-year-old daughter, even if it didn't say her name, I would know it was her because she is a woman of many words. She's a woman of intensity and passion. And I would know immediately it was my daughter Haley because she would be asking for money. Listen to me. That's the connection God wants with you and me. A relational connection that's so deep, that's so entrenched that we can hear his voice clearly and know it is him. And that he knows it is us when we speak with him. In fact, in John chapter 10, Jesus said this, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Listen, some of you have a really hard time and you're frustrated with reading the Word of God because you're trying to check off a box because a pastor told you to read the Word of God. Read the Word of God because it's a relational connection to your Father, and it will change the dynamic of what you read and how you read. Word and Spirit. But number two, write this down. God speaks in our generation through godly others. Now, if you're writing down that notes today, godly others, would you do me a favor and underline the word godly and circle the word godly? Because how many of you know there's a big difference between others and godly others? Others tell you what you want to hear. Godly others tell you what you need to hear. Godly others will be more worried about your future than they will your feelings. Godly others are people who might not necessarily agree with you on everything you think. They might enlighten you with hard truth. Now, I live in the South. You guys live in the Southwest, but I live in the South. And I don't know about Arizona, but in Texas, we will lie to you so we don't hurt your feelings. But of recent, Texas has been inundated with people from the Northeast. And what I've learned about the Northeast, they just tell you. They don't care about your feelings. I'm not classifying them as godly others. I'm just making the correlation. Sometimes we actually hurt people's growth by not telling them the truth. And godly others will tell you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear. Proverbs 12:15 says this, "Fools think their own way is right, but the wise listen to others." So who are the godly others in our lives? Who are these people? How do we identify them? Well, watch their lives. Watch how they live. Watch the valleys they've gone through and become victorious on the other side of it. Watch how they handled success. Watch if they're humble or if they're arrogant. Watch if they're prideful or if they're sensitive to the needs of you. I'm not saying they're not confident, and I'm not saying they're not strong, but at the heart of their heart is humility because they understand who God is and they understand who they are apart from God. Bible says God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Godly people understand fully God's amazing grace. I have some godly others in my life. I've already told you about the one that I would recognize her voice. I call her the Holy Spirit of my life. Her name is Sarah. She speaks all the time into my life. She encourages me when I need encouragement. She challenges me when I need challenged. She texts me this morning. She texted me before the first service. She said, "Let God speak through you today. It's not you, it's Him. You're going to kill it. You're going to do a great job. ... Don't screw it up." You want to get invited back, right? She speaks to me. She's a godly other in my life. I have mentors. I have other pastor friends in my life. Your pastor is a godly other in my life. You know, Pastor Lynn, week one, encouraged you to do this study in community, not by yourself. You know why? Because you need godly others to speak into your life. Christianity is not a solo sport, folks. It's to be done in community. You can get saved in isolation, but you cannot live in isolation because if you live in isolation, the enemy will devastate you. You need community. You need godly others. Speaking of Pastor Lynn, he has multiple times told me things that were truth that I needed to hear rather than things that I wanted to hear. In 2013 and 2014, I was going through the hardest seasons of my life when it came to ministry. I've been in vocational ministry since 1993, right out of Bible college as a 23-year-old kid. But 2013 and 2014 were the two hardest years. See, we started a church from scratch in our living room in 2008 with 24 adults and 10 kids. And we started getting momentum and we started growing. And how many of you know that God sends people to the church? How many of you also know the devil sends people to your church? Yeah. Well, I was really, really a wise leader because not only did the devil send one to our church, I hired him. And he was on our staff and the knives were deep in my back, and there was a coup that was being formed of about 11 or 12 families against my leadership and against our church. And let me tell you, it wasn't a godly other who was speaking truth. It was an enemy who was trying to destroy the momentum and the future of our church. I look back on it now, and I know exactly what was happening. I was in a meeting in California, and your pastor was at that meeting in the middle of this hard season of my life. Before the meeting that afternoon, they had set up the opportunity for us all to play golf, who wanted to play golf. And guess who I got paired with and was in my cart with me? Your pastor. So for 4.5 hours, I wore him out. I told him the entire situation, starting from when it started to the current reality of it. After 4.5 hours, I said, so what should I do, Lynn? He's like, are you going to ask me now? Yeah, before we're done, what should I do? And here's what your pastor said to me. How do you take a Band-Aid off? It's like, man, I'm talking about the devil, man, not about Band-Aids. He's like, no, how do you take a Band-Aid off? You soak it off or do you rip it off? I said, well, I just rip them off. He said, you need to go home and rip the Band-Aid off. Because if you don't, it's going to cost you and your church greatly. All right, I'll go home and do it. A year later, we're at the same meeting, 2014. Now we're at the same meeting in California, and they set up a round of golf before the meeting that afternoon. Guess who I get paired with? Your pastor. Guess who's in my cart? Your pastor. Guess what we talked about for 4.5 hours? The same situation. And he looked at me and he said, I told you to go home and rip it off and you're soaking it off. Why? I said, because I thought I could pray him out of it. I thought I could fix this problem. He said, go home and rip it off. I went home and I ripped it off the summer of 14. And it was like, on the other side of that, once we recovered from that, we just took off as a church. What was 24 people in a living room is now over 4,000 members. And we baptized 264 last year. And I'm telling you straight up, I look back on 13 and 14 and the devil was trying to destroy me and destroy what God was doing in our church. And I needed a godly other to tell me something that would protect my future rather than not hurt my feelings. Godly others are important in our life. And here's the third way God speaks, and this is the hard one. Everybody's like, I love that he speaks through the word and spirit, and I love that he speaks through my friends and my godly other community, but this one's hard. He speaks through circumstances. Like somebody in this room this weekend will be going through a circumstance you never dreamed in your life you would experience. I want to tell you, God is speaking in that. And some of you are going through things right now where life couldn't get any better. You're on the mountaintop and you're hitting on all cylinders. Let me just tell you, God is speaking through that. He's speaking in all the circumstances of our lives. James, the half-brother of Jesus, wrote a book in the New Testament. By the way, I think James gets a bad, bad deal the way people talk about the fact that he didn't believe that Jesus was the Son of God until the other side of the resurrection. But if your brother told you he was the Son of God, would you believe it? Right? So he gets a bad rap, but James, on the other side of the resurrection, he believes in Christ, and he writes this book. And look what he says in James chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. He says, dear brothers and sisters, you know who that is? That's the nation of Israel, and you know who that is today? That's you and me, brothers and sisters in Christ. He says, when troubles, other translations would say when circumstances, when troubles of any kind come your way, consider it an opportunity for what? Great joy. If you got a Bible right now, write in your Bible, oxymoron, James, that makes no sense. You're telling me when troubles come my way, that I should be joyful? Nope, you should have great joy. You should see it as an opportunity to show great joy in the midst of your circumstance, because no matter what you're going through, watch, you can grow through it. Because it didn't come to break you, it came, watch, to make you. Look what he goes on to say. He says, for you know when your faith is tested, that your endurance has a chance to grow. In other words, James would say, choose to grow through what you're going through. Because circumstances are the way God speaks in the testing of your faith. Because a faith that isn't tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. Okay, I'll say amen to that if you won't. A faith that isn't tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. Like today, if one of you invited me this afternoon to go skydiving, I'm going to tell you no. And then you're going to say why. I'm going to say because that's stupid. I might die. But if we did go skydiving and we went to the place where we get our parachute and they hand me my parachute, I'm going to ask these two questions. Has this thing been used before? And did it work? Because I don't want the one that just got shipped this morning from Amazon. I want the tested one. Come on, somebody. I want the tested one. God wants to know that you're going to stand firm no matter what comes your way because you've been tested, you've been refined in fire, and you've come out victorious on the other side. He's going to put you in circumstances to make you. By the way, how do we have a diamond? We have a lump of coal with pressure, time, and heat. Brings a beautiful diamond. Faith that isn't tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. Not only that, but James identifies the fact that the Christian life is not a sprint. He uses the word endurance. The Christian life is a marathon. And it's not about how we start this journey, it's about how we finish the journey. See, I could run a 100-yard dash today. It might take me 20 minutes to finish, but I'd get to the finish line. But if you told me you had to run a marathon today, I would need to train for a year before I'd ever be able to do that. Listen to me. You are in training. And until God calls you home, you're in training. And your endurance is growing to finish the race. How many of you have ever heard this statement? God will never give you more than you can handle. Anybody ever heard that? God will never put more on you than you can handle. If you've ever heard that, let me just let you know, that's the biggest lie from hell. Because there's been several occasions in my life that God has put more on me than I could physically and spiritually and mentally handle. You know why I know it's a lie? Because if I could handle everything that God puts on me, I wouldn't need God in the midst of it. I would be God, not him. God allows circumstances so he can speak to us in the valleys of our life so that when we get to the next mountaintop, we don't forget what he did in the valley. We're about ready to do something really crazy. We're going to send 400 of our best people to start a brand new church 15 miles north of us where there's another growth spurt where thousands are moving to. And we're going to send one of our very best staff pastors to pastor that church. When I say 400 of our best people, that's the truth because I gave him a list of others he could take. And he said, no, I don't want any of those. I'm like, no, please take those. And we are sending them and we are multiplying our church's impact by sending them to the town north of us. And in doing so, we're sending our next gen pastor. His name is David. We have a three-headed speaking team at our church. You have myself, a guy named Greg, and this guy, David. My mom and dad go to our church. That's always fun to preach when your mom and dad are in the room. I'll look right over here. This is where they sit. My dad will be going like this. David is such a great communicator that my mom will literally say to me, Brad, I love you as a son, but David's my favorite preacher at Rock Creek Church. Love you too, Mom. David and Jenna Smullen are going to plant this church, and they're going to kill it for Jesus. It's going to be a mega church. It's going to be a cornerstone. It's going to be a Rock Creek in our area. They're going to do amazing stuff. But David was born with cystic fibrosis. And when he was born, the doctors told his parents he wouldn't live past the age of 20. David's 38. And he's getting ready to start this church. And as they begin to get momentum, as they begin to get moving down the tracks of starting this church, he had some physical issues due to cystic fibrosis. Of course he did. And he wasn't able to eat and hold solid food because he had a blockage in his intestines. And so they did some tests, and they found that his intestines were twisted as a result of CF. So they did an operation on him where they cut a 10-inch line in his stomach and went in and reworked the intestines. The only problem is the surgeon hit a nerve. And when he hit the nerve, it paralyzed one of the intestines there or one of the areas of the intestines unknown to him. They sewed him back up, and David was fine for 2 weeks, but then he was back in the hospital because he was sick because he couldn't hold any solid food. They could not figure out what was going on. They just thought it was CF. They didn't know it was a paralyzed nerve on the intestine, and he spent 6 weeks in the hospital. In those 6 weeks, he couldn't eat solid food. For four, he lost over 30 pounds, and he didn't have 30 pounds to lose. My wife and I go to visit David and Jenna in the hospital. David's in the bed. They're feeding him through a feeding tube, and his wife Jenna's working on her laptop in the chair by the bed. And one of the first words out of their mouth is, Pastor, I think this church planting thing, I think we're done. I think you need to send someone else. This is too hard. We had no idea it was going to be like this. And if it's going to be like this, we're out. And then David looked at me and said, did you have any hardships when you planted? That's like, you want the list or just one thing? And then I looked at David and I said, did you think this was going to be easy? Did you think the devil was going to be happy with the fact that you were going to go to an area that is unreached and reach people with the gospel and take ground away from him? Did you think that it was going to be this easy? I know we're giving you money. I know we're giving you people, but the hounds of hell are going to come after you. You've got to stay the course, man. You got to stay in what God has called you to do. You can't quit. He goes, why? I said, because I've already hired your replacement. He's like, no, seriously. I said, you can't quit, man. Here's why. Here's why. Here's why you're going through this. Because if the enemy can stop you now, it will never be what God knows it can be. And instead of asking why, David, ask what? What is God trying to teach me in this season? On the other side of it, David's now been healthy as a horse for the last 3 weeks. They figured it out. They fixed everything. And the last 3 weeks, he's just been rejuvenated with the momentum of God, that he knew this. The enemy was trying to stop me because there's great potential in me. The enemy always comes against people with great potential. But just listen for the voice of God in your circumstances. Don't bail on God. Listen, don't pull away from God in those circumstances. Press in, because he'll speak to you through those circumstances. I wasn't supposed to be here this weekend. Honestly, I was supposed to preach for you guys the second weekend in January. But your pastor went and got bit by a dog. Seriously. He was supposed to have his knee replaced, and he gets bit by a dog, and the surgeon won't do the surgery because he's got an infection in the dog bite. The staff calls me and says, hey, don't come. Lynn got bit by a dog. It's like, what? Is this a joke? No, seriously, his knee surgery is being postponed. We need you to switch dates. Can you come the first weekend of February? And I said, yeah, I can work some things around. I can make that happen. Well, the weekend that I was supposed to be here, I preached at my church in Prosper, Texas. And after church, my dad met me in the lobby after our last service of four, just like you guys. And my dad says, hey, I'd like to take all of you guys to lunch. My sister, my brother-in-law, and her two hellions that are under the age of four, and mom and dad. And he says, I'm buying. I said, well, if you're buying, we're going Tex-Mex. So we're all there as a family around this big table. And I've got my back to the majority of the restaurant. I can see out the front windows. And during our dinner, during our lunch, I feel a tap on my shoulder, and I thought it was my wife sitting next to me, but when I turn, there's a woman standing between me and my wife. And I've never seen this woman before, and I've never seen her since. And she says to me in this moment, she says, I don't know who you are, and I don't know why I'm supposed to do this, but God told me to give this to you. And she gives me a piece of ripped off napkin that says, change direction, go right, amen. Now that'll just screw up the rest of your day, right? So as quickly as I read it, I looked up to see who she was and if she could explain this, and she was gone. I looked all over the restaurant for her, no sign of her. And so I've been turning right for 4 weeks. I'm just going in a circle. I'm not taking a left. I called a mentor. I sent him a picture. I said, what would you do with this? He said, I would listen to her, but I would look for him. And I'm like, okay, that's good, but how do I look for him in this? And he said, look for a verse. When you're reading the Bible in your quiet times in the morning, ask God to show you a verse that lines up with change direction, go right. I haven't found it yet. So would you pray for me? Because I'm carrying this everywhere I go. Here's what I want to tell you. I could discredit this and I could go, ooh, she's crazy. Or I could be sensitive to the fact that God's trying to tell me something. I think so many times we put God in a box. We want to keep him in our little mental capacity. God is so much bigger than us. He's so much grander than us. and he wants to speak to you. And sometimes he'll speak to you clearly right off the words of the page. And sometimes it'll be a friend or somebody who's a trusted part of your life. And sometimes it'll be somebody you've never seen before in a restaurant who hands you a note on a piece of a napkin. At the end of the day, God speaks. Press in. Tune into his voice. Listen, turn off the voices of the lies of culture and listen to the voice of love and truth. In this moment, would you just maybe take in your spirit a posture of the attitude of prayer? Just heads bowed and eyes closed in this moment as we wrap up. Just, I want to get you just to reflect. I know there's a lot of people in this room. It's full, but let's just imagine it's you and God. Just you and God in the quietness of this moment. I just want you to reflect on a few things. Just a few questions to think about. The first one is this. What is or has God been saying to you? What is he currently saying, or what has he said? What are some things that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the third member of the Trinity has illuminated in your life? That still small voice that won't shout at you, that will come at you like a whisper. What is or has God been saying to you? Second question, who or what is God using to speak to you? Who or what? Listen, don't sell God short. He spoke through a donkey in the Old Testament. God is speaking, and he will use all kinds of mediums to get his message to you. Third question, is what God's saying to you, maybe through a godly other or a circumstance, does it line up with what he's already said in his word? And the last question is, the circumstance that you're in right now, whether it's a valley or it's a mountaintop, what is God saying to you in that moment? How is he speaking to you in the circumstances you are in? And then as you reflect on those questions, would you just say to God, God, I'm going to press in to the fact that you're not trying to break me. You're trying to make me something beautiful. You're trying to make me more like your son, Jesus. And so I press in and I listen for that still small voice because you speak. So God, we come to you in a moment of prayer, in a posture of prayer and an attitude of prayer, just thanking you that you still speak. Thanking you that you didn't just speak to the heroes in the Bible, but you speak to the heroes in our generation. The men and the women of God that are passionately following after you. Lord, I pray that you would illuminate the word to us as we read it. Speak to us individually as it examines our life personally. God, I pray that you'd surround us with godly others who have our future in their mind, not our feelings. And then God, in the circumstances that we find ourselves in, we listen for your voice. Teach us, God, we are your servants and we are listening. And I pray this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thanks for allowing me to be back with you guys this weekend. Hope to be back again sometime soon. If you need prayer today, our prayer team's going to be down front. Just come forward. If you would like to text us a prayer request, you can just text the word prayer to 21999. Other than that, God bless you. Have a great rest of your weekend.